Dr. Sweeting, and members of the faculty, students, and friends, it's a real joy and a privilege for me to be here this evening. I was just thinking a moment ago, I think it was in 1962 when it was my first privilege to be invited to this great conference as a speaker. And I shall never forget the joy that was mine as we had wonderful fellowship in the Word and with the believers who gathered here. And now we're back again, and already I've heard great reports concerning the way the Spirit of God has moved in this place during this great conference.
Well, that's Howard Jones at Moody Memorial Week, and that CD is available along with the book, in addition to a song written and sung by H. David Jones. Good morning, Howard. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, my friend.
How are you, my friend?
It's fine, and you?
Real fine. I was watching Billy on Saturday night on TBN, I believe it was at 9 o'clock, and Ralph Bell was reading the scripture.
Oh, yes.
And he was an associate, as you were, for a number of years. Tell us that great story of Ralph Bell you talk about in your book, Gospel Trailblazer.
Now, what? In reference to what?
Well, this is where you were in Africa with Ralph.
Yes.
And there were some problems with the rebels and everything.
Oh, well, he was...
In Ghana?
He was with me in one of my crusades in Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
And we were there, and that's when the coup broke out.
Mm-hmm.
When Nkrumah was overthrown, his government, and we were trapped in the country for about 3 or 4 days. Ralph was in the interior, and I was in the city because I just finished the crusade. I was worrying about him, to whether he would get back, and he did. So we were trapped there, and the soldiers had machine guns on us, and it was quite a traumatic experience, a frightful one. And we couldn't get word out of the country to call my wife or his wife or Billy and the team, but finally the Lord delivered us, and we were glad.
Now, you were with Billy Graham for how many years?
37.
37.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you still speak on behalf of them, or you
retired? I'm retired now.
Oh, okay, all right.
But Billy and I keep in touch with one another. You've seen the Gospel Trailblazer, the book?
Yes, I have it right here.
Well, you see the picture of the two of us, Billy and me.
Right, yeah, that's right. He wrote the foreword.
Yeah, and I was down there in Cincinnati about 2 years ago, and we had 50 minutes together, and I told him that I was writing my autobiography, and would he write the foreword? He said, of course I would. Mm. And so, well, you see the picture. So we had 37 wonderful years with the team, and we thank God for Billy and his ministry today.
This is the second time we've had you on, but I think we're going to have you on once a week, every week for a year, and not cover everything we need to cover.
Well, it's a lot in the book.
Yeah.
But a lot we couldn't put in the book.
Oh, sure, sure.
Good.
Let me ask you this. I don't think anybody has won more souls to the Lord than Billy Graham in the 20th century, and I'm so grateful to God for that. A lot of folks are concerned, and I'm concerned as well, with some of the stands that he's taken. For instance, when he was here in St. Louis, I studied to be a counselor. I wanted to be a part of winning people to the Lord. But I had problems sending them back to churches that didn't preach the gospel, where the Bible was not taught as the final authority. In 1948, Billy Graham said the three greatest threats to this nation are communism, Catholicism, and Mohammedanism. He called it that. That's what they called it back then, instead of Islam. And yet, in the past few years, he's referred to Pope John Paul as the world's greatest evangelist. When he was here, I heard him say he wanted to thank the Jesuits for bringing the gospel to St. Louis. Well, Pastor Jones, you know, and I know, the Roman Catholic Church does not preach the gospel. They preach another gospel. Paul said, if I or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel than what's been preached to you, let him be accursed. He referred to Muhammad as a great prophet. Well, when I hear the word great, I always think of greatness, a person who's a great ball player, like Andre Thornton, your son-in-law. But I don't think of that person as being a false prophet. When you would hear some things like this, in fact, when Dr. Graham was here, I used to work for his radio station in North Carolina, WMIT, for a year. And I said, Dr. Graham, I said, I told him I was praying for Edna Edwards, who was the manager there at WFGW, WMIT. And then I said, you know, in John 15, Jesus said his followers would be hated by the world. And then I said, when I see the most loved and most appreciated list every year of men, women, you're either at the top or near the top. I said, how is that possible? And he mentioned that he wasn't popular all around the world. But when you hear him say things like this, isn't this throwing people who just come into the faith, isn't that throwing them off? Or people, missionaries, for instance, in South America who are preaching the true gospel, that people need to leave their churches that don't preach the gospel and come into a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and get into a church where the Bible is taught as the final authority. Doesn't that concern you when those things are said?
Well, that's a hard question, and I'm not speaking for Billy.
Mm-hmm.
We have to realize many times you've got to be very careful about taking something out of its context.
Mm-hmm.
See what I mean?
Right.
Now, speaking about the Catholic Church, I remember there was a time during the New York Crusade when Cardinal Spellman was a cardinal then, and he was bitterly opposed to Billy in the Crusade. And I remember many nights when people came to the Crusade and they came forward, they were going out a certain door, and it was apparent that some of our Catholic friends were attending the Crusade, but the Cardinal was not for it. Billy did not knock the church. He did not criticize him for saying that. But years later, Cardinal Cushing in Boston invited Billy to come and have tea with him. Well, Billy was very nervous about it, and he called a team meeting and asked what he should do. Well, we thought maybe since we were in Boston, he should go. When he went to see the Cardinal told him, he said, you know, Billy, we differ on many points in doctrine. But he said, there's one thing we agree on, and that's the cross of Jesus Christ. You preach the cross, and we believe in the cross, the sacrifice of Jesus. And he said, on the strength of that, I'm going to invite our Catholic constituency to come to the Crusade. Well, Billy was almost floored by that. Consequently, Catholics became interested in the Grand Crusade, and many of them came and made decisions for Christ.
But why do we send them back to those churches? There were 1,000 Catholics, Roman Catholics, that trusted Christ as their Savior, but they're going to be taught to depend on Mary, to pray to Mary when they go back to those churches.
Well,
now I know what they're doing. They're depending on the Holy Spirit of God to speak to these people. But I can't imagine Paul sending the Judaizers back to church that taught that doctrine.
Well, the point is, you're right, it's the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And if Paul were here today, he would agree that it's the Holy Spirit that leads people. You must realize that even in Christ's time, when the matter of taxes came up, he said, render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar and the things that are God. And so in our work as evangelists, we're not to judge people, we're just to sow the seed. And God will bring them to the place where the Word of God. And you notice, Billy always says, attend the church where the Bible is preached, mm-hmm. where the Word of God is preached. So this morning, I cannot take the place of Billy. I cannot speak for him.
Okay.
But I would not have stayed with him 37 years, and I can speak on behalf of others, if Billy hadn't been loyal to the Word of God
mm-hmm.
and preached the gospel. And you said that more people have come to Christ under his ministry than any other evangelist.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
We have to leave it with that.
That's right.
If
people could only get one truth from your book, The Gospel Trailblazer, what would you want that truth to be?
That Jesus Christ is the Savior. He died on the cross. He was buried in the grave. And he was raised from the... And that he's coming back. He's coming back one of these days. And that's the gospel we preach.
Amen.
That we're not saved by our works,
right?
But the saved blood of Jesus Christ. That's the message of the book.
Now, your son is also on this CD with you?
Yes, David.
Right.
He's quite a hymn writer. He writes songs. And he wrote that song there, Teach Me How to Worship, a very beautiful song.
All right.
And we thought it would be complete to put it at the end of my message.
And that, of course, comes with the book, Gospel Trailblazer. Christianity Today says that you're the Jackie Robinson of evangelism.
I don't know about that.
Okay. The Autobiography of Howard O. Jones with Ed Gelbreth is published by Moody. Thank you so much, Howard, for being with us today.
Thank you, my friend.
God bless you, brother.
Bye-bye.
Father God, I come to you today to give to you the worship due your name. I don't want to worship you in vain, because my heart has wandered far away. I just want to be your worship.
Jones, the son of Howard Jones, and that's featured on that CD with the message by Howard Jones in the book Gospel Trailblazer, again, forwarded by Billy Graham, available through our friends at Moody, Moody Publishers, available through our friends at Kingdom Treasures in Fairview Heights. All right, tomorrow we're going to be talking to Terry Miller, pastor of the Sunrise Pentecostal Church of God. He'll be with us in the 9 o'clock hour. He shared his testimony at the Metro Vision Banquet, and we had him once before, and we had to cancel, but we're going to have him in the 9 o'clock hour tomorrow. Mark Davis has written an article for the American Spectator on Hillary, the once and future president. He'll be with us. Also, Rusty Thomas and Angela Michael in the 8 o'clock hour. Richard Miniter, Losing Bin Laden, a new book published by Regnery. And Kathy Enns is going to be taking the bus to Washington for National Right to Life. Buses will leave Wednesday morning, and she'll be with us then. Live for the Lord, bring them all, tell your friends, neighbors about Jesus. Remember, I love you, especially Chris, David, and Jackie.
And don't forget, what a person believes determines what he does. How about a little bit of a song here from the Independent Baptist Mission for Asians, Samuel Manalo, Gideon Manalo, and Jay Manuel. And if you'd like to find out how you can record your own CD, we'll let you know on Wednesday.
Let me talk to Dave Steinhardt.
We walk together, the King and I. All holy.
the programming on KJSL is designed to amplify the particular views of the speaker, which are not necessarily those of KJSL, Crawford Broadcasting Company, or its sponsors.
KJSL, St. Louis.
The King and I.
Dick Eastman is the international president of Every Home for Christ and originator of the Change the World School of Prayer. He's the author of more than 10 books, several on prayer and intimacy with God. He's also serving as president of America's National Prayer Committee, formerly vice president. Good morning, Dick. Thanks for joining Tim and Al.
Hey, it's great to be with you.
And we're talking about your re-release of the 30th anniversary edition of No Easy Road. What was your prayer life before you began this interview with us this morning? Take us through what you did when you got up and what you, how you...
I just got back from a trip, so I just got up.
Okay.
So, over the years, I've developed a habit of making an appointment with the Lord every single day. And I tell people that, you know, they need to find the best time of the day for them, and not to be locked into that it's got to be any particular set time. In the sense, it's, I believe in a set time, but I don't believe it has to be either early in the morning or late at night. I believe a person needs to develop it, around their own schedules. And by the way, we all know some people are night owls, you know.
Right.
They pray great in the night. Jesus did.
Yeah.
And he got up early before dawn. Sometimes he prayed all night. But the reason, I'm really thrilled about the re-release of this book, even though No Easy Road has never really been out of print. The publishers felt they wanted to do an all-new edition because it just seems the Lord's raising up a new generation. And that new generation of people who pray, a lot of them are young people, but there's also a lot of people that are followers of Jesus for many years that never have resolved that issue. I need to have a daily, intimate encounter with God, and there are obstacles along the way, and that's what I try to describe in No Easy Road.
Now, has God called some of us to be intercessors, or all of us to be intercessors?
Well, I'm one of those that believes that because intercession is merely an aspect of prayer, of praying for others, and that all of us are really called to that. Now, some may have a very specific calling where it's just like a person called into the ministry or called into a specific career feel that because God has provided for them that they are to live a life of prayer. And yes, you could say that's a calling, but I am pretty adamant that every one of us ought to have that encounter, that quiet time with the Lord every day. I believe there's a biblical precedence for that throughout Scripture. In fact, to me, the Bible itself is largely a book of prayer. It's a book, mm-hmm. a book of people who were close to God, who knew the Lord, and talked with Him daily. And therefore, I believe some may have a unique calling in prayer, but all of us have what you might call the gift of prayer, in the sense that God has given us the privilege of coming to Him, the privilege of meeting with Him, sharing our concerns with Him. And like Alfred Lord Tennyson said, more things are wrought by prayer than this world dreams of.
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore, let our voices rise like a fountain day and night. What I try to do in No Easy Road is just paint a picture that there's joy at the end of this journey.
Mm-hmm. You know, there are two things that get in the way of my prayer life. And one of those, you talk about the prayer of unbelief, because there's a lot that is spoken of in the Bible about the mustard seed, about praying for the fervent prayer of a righteous man, believe, nothing wavering. It goes on and on and on. And yet there are times when I have to say, God, I don't see any way, humanly speaking, that this thing is going to get accomplished. And frankly, while I know you can do it, I have a lot of doubt here, and you're going to have to help my unbelief. And I feel terrible praying a prayer like that.
Yeah, but I think it's good. I think one of the important things, first of all, to understand, to me, the greatest lesson I learned about prayer, and this would be more than three decades ago when I determined I was going to have a daily appointment with the Lord. It was going to be on my daily calendar.
Mm.
And when that was resolved, I had that prayer time every single day, and I do now, even though it may vary in its time. Usually now, because of my lifestyle of incredible travel, it's It's late in the afternoon, and sometimes it does continue for quite a while, in fact, most days. But what I learned was that the most important purpose for prayer is simply to be with God, because God is the answer to my every prayer that I would ever pray, even if I don't think to articulate it. And, you know, in Jeremiah 29, verse 11 and 12, it says, I have a plan for you. It's a good plan, a plan with a future and a hope. And then it says, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And years ago, I was praying, and that passage was open, and I looked at the word me, you will seek me, and I circled it, and find me, and I circled me again, when you search for me with all your heart. And I circled me the third time, and I didn't know why I was doing it, but I heard the still small voice of the Lord in my heart say, when I finished circling the third me, I felt this impression, you've just circled the three most important words in all the Bible on the subject of prayer, because prayer isn't how many answers you can get, but how much of me you can touch. And it's not that we don't pray for specific things, but I'll tell you one thing I'm convinced of is hope and faith is really built as we simply spend time close to the Lord and in prayer, in the Word, in prayer. Because, you know, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the Word. So at first a person might not feel much is happening in their daily encounters with the Lord. But then as they're faithful, that faith builds, and then soon a habit develops, and you don't want to miss the prayer time. Whether you feel you're seeing a lot of the answers or not, you just know that by touching God, everything's going to fall into place.
You mentioned in the book that God gives you 96 15-minute time periods every day. Will you give God at least one or two of these time periods in prayer for your loved ones, friends, and the world? Let me ask you this. How much time do you spend listening to the Lord? In other words, I never even thought about that until somebody brought that to my attention a while back. And this one fellow I knew who listened to the Lord for about an hour every morning. He'd pray, and then he'd listen for an hour, and he'd write it down. He'd end up in China somewhere.
Well, and this is that's a good illustration, because not that you have to listen, say, for a whole hour, but I would say that fully half of my times of prayer would be in what would be described as the contemplative modes of prayer. Those aspects of prayer would include listening and meditation, quietly reading the Word in reference to that day or decisions I have to make. But anytime you're reading the Bible, if you're reading it to hear, that's a listening type of prayer. Thinking deep into God's Word, or just meditating on aspects of God's nature and character. All of these things, by the way, are qualities that can be developed just like any other spiritual discipline. And what I try to do in No Easy Road is, and the Lord led me years ago in first developing this, was I was impacted by Pilgrim's Progress, that great classic on prayer, our classic on the Christian life, Pilgrim on His Journey, and decided to weave that thought into a book. And that's why this is really a Pilgrim's Progress-like journey along the road of prayer, until we reach the top of the mountain of God's power. And from there, we see things we've never seen before. From there, we have new authority, and there is a joy that we never even imagined in prayer. But we've got to fight a little to get there, and that's the challenge.
Let's talk a little bit about some of the people that you highlight in the book. Let's talk about first Billy Bray.
Well, Billy Bray was what I like about Billy Bray was his being an evangelist, by the way, more than 100 years ago, but one of those who became filled with the passion of God. And the great statement he made, one of them, was when someone asked him once, how's the world getting on? And he said, I don't know, I haven't been there for 12 years. You know, this seems so far removed from many of us today, because, look, we have to admit that to live in today's world is thoroughly different.
Yeah, now see, there's somebody out there thinking right now, well, see, that's one of those guys who's so heavenly minded he's no earthly good.
Yeah, well, some people are so earthly minded they're no heavenly good.
That's right, yeah.
The fact is that there is still a place for us to carve out a segment of our day to become just a little more heavenly minded. Where is it? Colossians 3, the first couple of verses, where it says, fix your thoughts on heaven, you know. And we need to do that. And one of the things in No Easy Road that I did, and that's why some, you'll find some of this timeless, because we go back and we look at these incredible warriors of past generations who set such a powerful example in their prayer lives. You know, the Martin Luthers who said, I have so much work to do today. I've got 3 days worth of work to do today. The only way I could possibly get it done in one day is if I spend the first 3 hours in prayer.
Now, there's somebody listening and saying, wait a minute, Martin Luther, he said some nasty things about the Jews. Now, did he not have his devotions that day when he, you know, he said those things?
One thing you point out is some of that may be true, where in the generation in which they lived, there's a historic record of some things that may not have been pleasant. And you know, over the generations, and especially when you go back to these historic leaders that lived in some really incredible trying times, there are some aspects of either their theology, their interpretation, or even their personality that sometimes is troubling. I mean, for example, John Wesley was a remarkable, remarkable man of God, but had a horrible marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And probably some would really hold that against him today, if that were, you know, if there were a leader like that.
But he said, I thank God for the wife that I have, because if I had any other kind of wife, I would have been less faithful to the itinerant ministry.
But
you had problems with Catherine Coleman.
Well,
tell us that situation.
Well, I didn't have problems.
No, no, but you know, theologically, you had some difficulties with it.
Oh, yeah, well, I think it was more, and what I shared in that opening illustration was, her mannerisms were just odd to me.
Mm-hmm.
At that time in my ministry, I went to hear her, and she was very, very dramatic. Just the way she conducted her meetings. But at the same time, God, as I said, God used that initial encounter and hearing her in a ballroom in San Francisco to kind of begin to kick the sides out of my box, you know, my mm-hmm. theological box. We tend to put God in a box.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got to, you know, kind of operate within our interpretation. And as I told in the introduction, probably if I rewrote that again, I would use a different word than odd, because some people misinterpret that. Except that's exactly what I felt.
Mm.
I mean, at the time when I first, I thought, what a strange lady.
Yeah.
I mean, my first encounter that way was, my goodness. Well, then I started seeing what God was doing
through her.
And as I shared actually in that introduction, the whole book, No Easy Road, came out of where I lost my voice and thought I would never preach again, and I started to write, and God said, I'm one night deep in prayer, I'm calling you to a life of prayer, and he knew I had to shut up in order to listen to him.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in that meeting, after about 9 months of thinking I'm never going to preach again, and the doctors didn't know what to do, that I went to that meeting, and all of a sudden, in the middle of the meeting, 3,000 people sitting at tables, which made the room look 5 times bigger than even that number, and she's pointing out at our table, which is in the middle in the middle of the room, way of the ballroom, way in the back on the right, and she's pointing, saying, there's a young man there. She had no idea who I was. There's a young man there with a throat condition for many months. The Lord's healing you now. And it felt like hot oil pouring down through my throat.
Mm.
I was literally back in the pulpit of our church in Sacramento the following Sunday, and preached 10 consecutive Sundays on the chapters that became No Easy Road. So I learned then that God uses people who may come across
probably
a little differently.
Well, I know that was true with me. When I went to see her, I saw her about 5 times in Los Angeles. And the first time I went to see her, I thought you, the same thing you did. I thought this lady is nuts, and yet, in fact, we used to air her program on KHUF in Southern California, and I couldn't stand her voice, so I'd click the mic so I wouldn't hear her voice. But when you went to the miracle service, you could sense God's presence. You knew God was there. And I remember her saying, you know, I'd see people falling into the power and everything. I'd think, oh, brother. And then I said to myself, and people would go up and say that they had been healed of this and healed of that. And I said to myself, I said, you know, all these healings are wonderful, Catherine, but the most important healing is the spiritual healing. And no sooner did that come out of my mouth silently than she said, now all these healings are wonderful, but the most important healing is the spiritual healing. How many of you people here would like to trust Jesus as your personal Savior? Come down front. And people ran to the front. And I remember my wonderful Baptist preacher father, next to Jesus, the greatest man who ever lived, would say, is there anybody here who would like to trust the Lord as their Savior? Quickly slip up your hand. We'll sing one more stanza, Just As I Am. We've sung it 17 times already, but we'll sing. I think there's one. And then I realized, Mark 16:20, the purpose of signs and wonders. Yeah, there's Jesus showed the signs and wonders, and the Pharisees were seeking for more. And Jesus said, no, wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after signs. I've given you plenty of signs. But he said, these signs shall follow those who believe.
Well, you know, one thing that was interesting in this whole story of Catherine Kuhlman, which I didn't follow through further in that introductory chapter, but the following year after my healing, I wrote No Easy Road, and Catherine Kuhlman came back to Memorial Auditorium in Sacramento. She literally she invited all the pastors to come. There were hundreds, and she picked me out. She said, young man, you come here. She had no idea of my previous healing. She prayed for me 6 times. Each time I couldn't stand up, and I didn't know what was happening. I could try, but I couldn't stand up. And each time I felt that something that was emptying out of me, that I was becoming more fully the Lord's. And each time she said, well, prophetically, oh, does the Lord have a great plan for you?
Mm.
She didn't know
that
this book had resulted, and now here it is, all these years later, and through the ministry of Every Home for Christ, for example, in Nepal, which, you know, was a totally Hindu state, is a totally Hindu state, but democratic freedoms came about 10 years ago, and our ministry now, we're in more than 100 countries. We go to every home with the gospel. In Nepal, we've now reached every home in Nepal, and 270,000 former Hindus have filled out our decision card in our literature. And I think of Nepal, where our director there says, Dick, 60% or more of all the people who have genuinely come to Christ now in Nepal have done so in some relationship to signs and wonders. He said that's what is impacting them. And so, you know, there is something to be said about this. Of course, prayer is what opens the heavens for the miraculous. And now I'm not just trying to say everybody needs to have some kind of experience like we've been describing to really know there's a God. But I believe we need an intimate time with the Lord every day. And it's, you know, it's a challenging journey, but like anything, it's like the athlete that trains for hours and hours every day and then goes to the Olympics and wins the gold medal. And I believe there's a real prize for the person that gets on this journey and stays with it.
Well, one more guy I got to ask you about. My friend Adjie McKay used to bring up his name an awful lot. Rhys Howells.
Oh, my, yes. Well, Rhys Howells was one of the most remarkable intercessors in certainly in Christian history in the last 200 or 300 years. Rhys Howells lived during World War II primarily, and before that, but had a Bible school in England, and really it was a prayer school, is really what it was. And there are different places where I described in this book, literally, they're praying at night, and the following day, or 2 days, they read in the headlines of the London Times or whatever the newspaper was then, absolute answers to their prayer. I received a letter from a United Methodist pastor in Dallas, Texas one day who said, Dick, I'm reading No Easy Road. And this is what the letter said. I'm at page 101. He said, I'm weeping. I'm just weeping. He said, I was at the Battle of Salerno. He said, I saw the very miracle you described. I saw it with my eyes. He said, I didn't know Jesus then. He said, it was through that miracle that I came to Jesus. What I didn't know was the people who were praying at the exact time in England, in Reese Howell's school. He said, I never ever knew that the miracle I saw was not only an answer to prayer, but because I was spared that night, I went on to come to know Jesus. Now I'm in the ministry. And he said, I can't hold back the tears. That was one of the most moving letters I've ever received.
Wow. Now, is that book still in print, Reese Howell's Intercessor by Norman Grubb?
Yeah, Reese Howell's, you can get that. I don't know who the publisher is. Probably Christian Literature Crusade,
right.
PLC.
Yeah.
Reese Howell's Intercessor, oh yes, that's still in print. The reader, if someone reads my book, No Easy Road, they'll notice that in numerous places I share some of the more incredible stories from Reese Howell's. And by the way, there's in our ministry, Every Home for Christ, we just dedicated our $8 million Jericho Center, where we have two rooms just above the entry. When you come in, you drive your car in and drop people off, and above the entry is the harp and bowl rooms, one for continuous worship, where we have a real harp, and the other for continuous intercession. That's the bowl room from Revelation 5:8, the picture of the harp and the bowl, and the elders coming and singing a new song, that out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, the redeemed have come. And I mention that because we just dedicated that. Jack Hayford came in and dedicated it, and we had leaders from all over the body of Christ. And the purpose of the Jericho Center, which is the theme, we use that theme because all the tribes came together at Jericho, and God responded supernaturally. And the purpose of the Jericho Center for Global Evangelism, as the whole name is to plan strategic initiatives of multiple ministries who want to cooperate together in impacting a whole region or nation. And the Lord put on our hearts that if we would enthrone Him and continually intercede and worship over these strategies, He would do things that the church has never seen. And so even in our dedication week, our very first consultation was on the Middle East, and a whole plan emerged of about 12 major ministries just for Iraq in 2 days, and that plan is already underway. It's absolutely amazing, and I mention that in the context of Reese Howell's because this is a Reese Howell's-like thing that God's doing, and we're not the only ones. We have the World Prayer Center in Colorado Springs, in which we're very closely related with their World Prayer Team of mobilizing people through the web, you know, internet, mm-hmm. millions to pray, and there's just a lot that has kind of the spirit of Reese Howell's in it, if I can use that expression.
Sure.
That's happening.
Before we let you go, would you lift up our nation in prayer, our president in prayer, his advisors, our men and women in Iraq right now, the families who have loved ones there, and that all of us will get closer to the Lord as a result of spending more time in His presence and in intercessory prayer.
Father, we do just come to You rejoicing at the privilege, the extraordinary gift You've given us to come before You and declare Your counsels, declare Your will. First, Lord, Your will is that no one should perish, but all should come to a knowledge of repentance. And therefore, Lord, all of our praying has that ultimate eternal focus. And Lord, I pray, I do pray, and in agreement with this listener, each listener that would just even say, yes, Lord, I agree. I pray for our president, Lord, especially at this season. We know, Lord, there's a lot of criticism. Father, we know that our president meets with You each morning. He talks with You. He declares that Christ, Jesus Christ, is His Lord, and we want to lift Him up. We want to be the Aarons and Hurs beside Him, lifting up His sometimes tired hands in these challenges for the Middle East, for Israel, Lord, for Iraq and everything that's happening. And Lord, we do pray that You would open the heavens above America, and we ask, Lord, for a mighty spiritual awakening to sweep our land. And Lord, I pray for each listener now that they would pursue this journey of prayer, that they would discover the joy of it, that they themselves, each one, could meet with You intimately in a daily basis and discover the joy of this journey. Lord, I just pray that You would open their understanding to the beauty of this, and they would pursue it. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Your website, what is what, Dick?
Yes, our website is www.ehc, for Every Home for Christ, without the F there, ehc.org. And our 800 number is 800-423-5054. That's 800-423-5054. And anybody that does call, we do have a beautiful edition now that we give free of our world prayer map that helps people pray
not only for the nation systematically, a few of them a day, so they go to all the world each month, but there's a place they can draw their neighborhood, sketch it out, so they can pray for their neighbors every day, too.
Very good. The late Dr. Bill Bright, founder and chairman of the Campus Crusade for Christ, said Christians need to master the discipline of prayer, and now you have the opportunity to learn at the feet of a true prayer warrior. It's called No Easy Road. Discover the extraordinary power of personal prayer, 30th Anniversary Revised Edition, 750,000 copies in print. Dick Eastman, thank you so much for being with us today.
It's really been my joy.
God bless you, brother.
Thanks.